You're listening to DraftKings Network.
It's done.
Connor McDavid! It's not real!
The goal of the year.
Panarin!
Part of the past. The celebrations. Forgotten. The history.
Vegas Golden Knights!
History. Win. We're back to a blank slate. Clean ice. All that matters now is what happens next. The Stanley Cup Playoffs.
Eastern Conference Final begins Wednesday.
This is the Dan Le Batard Show with the Stugatz Podcast.
Not unlike Donald Trump has figured out that if you just inundate the news stream with all manner of shame, we can't keep up with it all and your shamelessness will be able to win. Stugatz has figured out how it is to bombard our show and all its producers with so much information in real time that we can't keep up with the game of whack-a-mole. So he said recently that Michael Jordan would never lose two home games in a row in the playoffs, and then we looked it up and found out that he had. Mm-hmm. And he also said that Michael Jordan would never go 6-for-24 in a playoff game, but against the Pacers, he did go 9-for-25 in a playoff game. But it doesn't matter. Because in Stugatz's memory, Michael Jordan shot 100% from the field in his career. And so we've sent him off to jail where he is presently sitting with the giant head of Scottie Scheffler, five or six times the size of
terrifying,
Stugatz's
honestly.
Head. Stugatz, what are you doing in there with the jail in the jail cell with Scottie Scheffler?
Well, Dan, you know, Scottie turned to me. He asked, hey, can you help me out? And I said, I can help you out. If you go, I go. And so I am now currently in a prison cell with Scottie Scheffler. He should have been arrested for the size of his head. He wasn't, but I am going to get Scottie Scheffler out of here in no time for the right amount of money. Okay?
He's just closer to the camera, guys. It's a perspective thing.
Yeah.
It's not a prison. It's a jail, Stugatz. Those two things are different.
Are they?
Put it on the poll, please, at
yes.
Le Batard Show. Do you know the difference between a prison and a jail?
Do you know the difference of 6-for-24 and 9-for-27? Just, I'm wondering, just out of curiosity.
It was 9-for-25.
Oh, even better for Michael. How about that?
That's a clean sell.
By the way, Dan, Scottie can't talk. He's very upset about this. He has to get to the second round of the PGA. There was no reason he should have been arrested, so you won't be hearing from Scottie Scheffler, okay?
Okay, so you are acting as his attorney in jail, his accomplice?
His friend, Dan. His friend who would do anything for Scottie Scheffler. You know what I'm talking about, Scottie?
All right, go ahead and give us the backstory there, because I do think it's interesting, Greg. How look at me would you have been if you had been the only reporter with video access to that news story? How available, how quickly would you have hired a publicist, a publicity team, and how available would you have immediately become to the American media?
I mean, I would have, I'd have t-shirts in my merch store of me at 5 a.m. wearing a miner's helmet with a light on it. I would be doing every single show imaginable. I would have done a live Greg Cody Show podcast episode live at 4:30 in the morning. Would have done it all, man. You got to take advantage. Look at Scheffler, he never blinks. You have to take advantage of a situation like that. Darlington, I feel like, left the ball on the ground. Although, if this thing does go to trial and Scheffler is prosecuted, key witness, eyewitness, Jeff Darlington.
Jessica, do you think that Darlington buys himself anything in hiding from the look at me of this? We asked him to come on, and the only reason we wanted him on was just to talk about how surreal it was to be him that day and get caught up in that storm, and he wants the work to speak for itself.
I feel like he's doing the thing from the newsroom where he's like, I reported the news, you know? And I kind of like that for him.
Lame.
He sort of is the news, though, in a certain
I reported
respect.
The news.
Pablo can be very look at me. Pablo has a young theater kid as a kindergartner that has been pushed down his entire life. Pablo, how would you, Pablo Torre Finds Out is the name of the podcast, and it is getting very popular. How would you have handled the entire Scheffler situation if you were the only reporter who had video of that? Would you have been a news hound, or would you have been, look at me, I want to do the publicity tour for being the news?
Well, I think Jeff Darlington did what a journalist should do when you're presented with a situation where you're right behind in the car behind, and you get out and you tape and you have the only camera footage that you have because the body cam was off. Why is this a controversy? Wait, who's objecting to his instinct there? Is it because he's not doing interviews about this?
Well, Greg, answer the question, Pablo. You didn't answer the question. Greg, great deflection. What would you have done, brother?
Yeah. What would you have done?
I would have done that, and I would have tried to, when I was pushed. I mean, look, I'm not trying to do, like, I'm a bigger, tougher journalist than Jeff Darlington. I'm not saying that. I would have done what he would have done and tried to see how long I could stay out there to get footage. That seems like an obvious call to me.
Oh, so you would have pushed against the police and risked your own arrest.
Well, I'm not saying that a goal of mine would be to get arrested. I'm just saying Jeff Darlington was within his rights to be there and to do that. Right? Like,
Pablo.
What?
The Look At Me reporter, yes, he was within his rights, absolutely. We're marveling at his restraint, at his not wanting to be the story. Greg and Stugatz would have wanted to just be closer to everything that was happening there, and Stugatz has now created the scenario where he ends up in jail with Scheffler as a freedom fighter.
A crusader, Dan.
Pablo, let's check in now with Stugatz here so he can give you his position, because you've dropped the ball. With time to think about it, you failed here, Pablo, to get maximum attention for Pablo.
I'm disappointed. I'm seeing what Stugatz is doing here, I am learning from the master.
Yeah, listen, the game is going to pass you by, Pablo, okay? It's not about the news. It's not about journalism. It's about you. It's about your brand. And what you do in that spot is you do what I did. You get arrested with Scottie Scheffler. You go to prison with Scottie Scheffler. That's reporting. Jay. That's journalism. That's Look At Me, Louie. That's what journalism has turned into these days. Darlington squandered an opportunity. I'm sitting here. I have the keys to the cell, okay? Oh, my God. This is great. I'm getting Scheffler out, and me and Scheffler are going to be buddies for life, 80-20 my way. Keys to the cell. You like that, Dan?
You're still making it prison. It's not prison. He was stretching in jail. You don't want to be doing that in prison.
Stugatz has him and Scottie Scheffler doing the Shawshank Redemption thing together.
Yes.
He has them escaping together.
Yes.
The part of this is you going to be in jail the rest of the day. Scottie going to be out in an hour.
That's what you do for a friend, Juju. That's what you do to make. And then the story becomes all about you, because you are left alone in prison, and Scheffler, hopefully after he fires a 66, second round PGA, comes to get you out. Stugatz, that's a story. That's how you do it, right, Scottie?
You're only getting the second best lawyer in Louisville if this happens to you. You know that, right?
Doesn't matter. I don't need an attorney. The longer I sit in jail, prison, whatever Dan wants to call it, the better for me. The longer I sit there and people are talking about, oh, my God, Stugatz, he did something nice for Scottie Scheffler. Can you believe 14 days later, he is still sitting in jail?
You guys don't understand.
Oh, what a story.
Yes, he would go on a hunger strike in jail. They'd be trying to let him out. They'd open the doors, and he's like, no, I'm staying here imprisoned in the attention.
Stugatz, you can go now. No, I don't want to go. I'm going to make this my home for a couple of weeks. Why? Because that makes me even bigger than I already am. How about that? You can let Scottie go. Keep me in here for a month for all I care. Three squared, Dan.
Stugatz would reveal to the police from inside of the jail cell that he had marijuana vape cartridges on him.
Yes.
He would do the reverse grinder just to stay in there for as long as possible.
You should check out my house. I mean,
do you think jail's a hotel you just come and go as you please to?
I'm not saying it's comfortable, but Billy, when I get out in 30 days, oh my God, I'm going to replace David Muir on 2020. How about that? Seriously, am I wrong, Dan?
Just morally and in general, you are wrong, but you are right.
Pablo, I put myself in the cell with Scottie Scheffler. That's journalism, my friend.
That's not.
BFFs for life as well after that.
Are you taking journalism classes while you're in prison?
No. I am reading a book, Stugatz's personal record book. You can check it out here. That's what we do in prison, Dan. We have time.
Letters from a Louisville jail. Stugatz goes Martin Luther King.
We like to read in jail. Yeah. Stugatzbook.com. Check it out. My personal record book. Scottie, I'll sign one for you.
We will check back in with Stugatz in jail in a moment.
Scottie?
But he does have this right. He could. Jeff Darlington blew a glorious chance at doing everything Stephen A. Smith did to capitalize on a Sunday.
Thank you.
In terms of brand management, Jeff Darlington.
Stugatz tunnel walking with cameras around him into jail. Yes. Stugatz, selfie stick.
Now, how about that, brothers?
I want you to imagine Scheffler on a boat somewhere cleaning it up, and Stugatz walking up like Tim Robbins in Shawshank Redemption because they're lifelong. He and Red are lifelong buddies. Stugatz would have absolutely parlayed that into a heavenly buffet of what can I get from the number one golfer in the world?
Look at him. You're so right.
The irony of Stugatz being the one who ends up in a First Amendment lawsuit with a police department and not you, Dan, for reporting the news would be, I think, that would be great, right? That would be hilarious.
It is appropriate that Stugatz becomes the Edward Snowden of sports media because he wants to be in jail with Scotty Scheffler.
I don't know who that is, but I agree with you, Pablo. I mean, Snowden, genius, this guy.
Darlington, you're a fool.
Thank you.
You are holding on to an antiquated set of journalistic ideals. You should.
I don't want to be the story. What are you, a moron? Oh my God! You're a bigger moron than Scotty. You should be arrested for being a moron. I love you, Jeff.
Stugatz definitely thinks Edward Snowden is like another golfer, right?
that just walked out of jail. Yeah, he's doing whatever he wants freely.
Just missed the cut on Sunday, Edward Snowden.
It's unfortunate. Do it in a major.
Since the dawn of mankind, we've cooked our food over an open flame and debated the best way to grill. One thing not up for debate, grilling and beer always go together. And not just any beer will do. Whether you barbecue Texas style or celebrate Wednesday with burgers and dogs, you need a beer that tastes great and is less filling, so you have more room for food. You need Miller Lite. As you guys may or may not know, I'm a pretty decent cook, especially behind the barbecue. So when I start the fire from my smoker on a hot day, really, the only thing that I have to worry about is what wood I'm going to use. The easiest decision for me is what I'll be drinking. That's a nice ice-cold can of Miller Lite. Oh, and by the way, here's a pro tip. It really goes well with brisket. Miller Lite keeps it simple, undebatable quality, and tastes as great as your barbecue. A perfect companion for grillmasters across America. With the Miller Lite in hand, grilling doesn't just taste great, it tastes like Miller time. To get Miller Lite delivered right at your door, visit MillerLite.com/Dan. Or you can find it pretty much anywhere that sells beer. Celebrate responsibly. Miller Brewing Company, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. 96 calories per 12 ounces.
Don Lebatard.
Quiet man.
Yes.
You know, I'm a married man. I don't cheat on my wife, despite that gratuitous line in back in
that
my
you
day.
Wrote.
Stugatz.
I wish you were here, my wife. I really miss her. No, I don't. That's the thing about being married. You know, you're not allowed to say, I don't miss my wife. I've been gone 2 days. I haven't been gone long enough to miss my wife. I'm sorry. I call her.
You
I'm on the phone with her for 30 seconds. You know,
that
what am I? Hello. All right. All right. We'll see you. All right. And then, you know, I'm going to see her in 2 days. How's Jumpin' Charlie? Good.
This is the Dan Lebatard Show with the Stugatz.
Pablo, what is on Pablo Torre Finds Out? Where are you following your curiosities in this episode?
Oh, today is the most journalistic investigation we've ever done, Dan. It is me and Mina Kimes and David Dennis Jr. watching all of X-Men 97 and talking about it. So I don't know if anybody here had the childhoods that we had. We've been waiting 30 years to talk about a cartoon. We talked about the cartoon. It's the horniest cartoon I've ever seen, and it made me very happy to talk about all of it.
Everyone I have heard talk about it, I don't know whether it's tapping into nostalgia, childhood, or what, they say it is exceptionally well done, well written, and that it's a piece of art worth, not just if you're looking, channeling it through the filter of childhood, but a modern day piece of art independent of that.
It's tremendous. And I just want to ask Greg, personally, can you attempt to give us a summary of what you think X-Men 97 is about? What do you imagine this show is?
I'm not a big superhero cartoon kind of guy.
Good start.
I mean, X-Men, I assume, is a group of five superheroes all trying to outdo each other. I have no idea.
I like really it don't. As five former men.
That's right.
Okay. What is it? It's a cartoon, right?
It's a cartoon. It's a cartoon, Greg, about mutant powers and superheroes. That's sort of an analogy for civil rights in America and so forth and so on. But I want you to actually give, can you give us the names of what you think these superheroes, the five superheroes, what are their names, do you imagine?
The Avenger.
Great.
Green Lantern.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible Hulk.
Okay, you're just plagiarizing actual superhero names.
There. Batman and Godzilla.
How many did I get
please,
right?
Please make a t-shirt.
It's a good list.
That is all of those things as X-Men.
Yes. See?
Yes. Watch that.
That's merch.
That's what you should be doing your show about, my five guys. So, did I get any right? Did I get any right? I'm just curious.
You could not have been more wrong, but okay. Although Godzilla is a brilliant addition to the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Thank you.
The multiverse should welcome in. Yeah.
I think
One more thing I was thinking about, Dan, was there's this story about how AI, OpenAI, is like being sued by Scarlett Johansson because they're taking her voice and they're using that to be the voice of like our, of course, future dystopia. I think Greg Cody should be the voice of OpenAI. I think there's a giant missed opportunity in not having Greg Cody be a voice option for your computer when it talks to you.
Really? Can I say anything I want?
Well, I mean, it would be a bunch of different things that would resemble artificial intelligence.
Oh, so I have to talk according to what I'm asked to speak about.
No, they use your voice to say whatever they want as you.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if I'd go for that.
All right. Let's talk we'll to see. Pablo about the serious parts of this instead of the parts about Greg Cody formulating a voice. The Scarlett Johansson story has been a story here for a couple of years that I don't believe is being covered very well because she's rightfully pissed off about things that are being taken from her that are supposed to be hers in a changing technological world. What are the areas of this story that are most illuminating to you?
I think it's just how on the nose it is because it's all based on the fact that Sam Altman, the founder of OpenAI, I mean, I think OpenAI is an incredibly impressive company that is almost less untrustworthy as a super villainous concept, like they're trying to kill everybody on the planet. I don't think they're trying to do that. I think what they're just doing is clumsily trying to sell people products. I think capitalism is a story of artificial intelligence. And so there's this movie called Her, in which Scarlett Johansson plays, her voice plays, the voice of the sentient general intelligence robot AI. And what Sam Altman did was essentially say to himself, that movie's cool. I want that to be real life artificial intelligence. And it just leaves me not trusting him on the level of business. Like, it's so clumsy. The idea that you're using the apocalyptic movie voice to be the real life voice of the thing you're making in reality, it feels just deeply disconnected. It's sort of like how people watch movies and they don't know who the villains are. And I think Sam Altman is realizing, or maybe he's only now realizing, how on the nose it is for them to inhabit a fictional world in which AI is a nightmare and then try to sell that to people under the guise of, man, this is awesome, isn't it?
But the problem, right, is that they asked her to use her voice and then she's saying that she said no. And then when the voice came out yesterday, it sounded exactly like her. And so she's now suing them over that. And then I think he also had a tweet a month or so ago where, or maybe a couple years ago, I'm not sure, where he tweeted her, like the name of the movie. So I think that, is that not what the lawsuit's about?
Yes. So what's happened is that Scarlett Johansson said, no, I don't want to do that. And they basically have the powers to, as they do, simulate anyone's voice. And so I think they're claiming that they hired a voice actress who is not Scarlett Johansson to do this, but they hired essentially a Scarlett Johansson impersonator. And so whether or not they simulated her voice or hired a human who sounds a lot like her, it is exactly what an AI company, the caricature of one, would do. And so, yeah, Dan, what it does is it speaks to every sort of sense that you might have as someone who creates something, that this company is not to be trusted, that they're just going to take from real people to simulate those real people and use that real person's voice against their will to create more technology to do exactly that forever.
I want to ask the group of you what you think of when you think of a movie that was way ahead of its time. I don't know if Her is ahead of its time or of
it, was.
Well, but of its time, because there were plenty of people living in this space before I was. Obviously, I've aged out, and artificial intelligence, all of it has sort of caught me off guard, but there were plenty of people living off the grid 10 years ago when Her made an appearance. I want to ask the group to think of the movie you most associate with being ahead ahead of its time. But what is happening with Stugatz right now, Billy? I don't understand. He is now in jail by himself. No longer. Scottie Scheffler has
Scotty's
got,
out. Yeah,
Scottie has
got,
out.
Got him out, Dan. Yeah.
Okay. So now where's this story going, Stugatz?
Well, it's going with me sitting in prison by myself because the cops came, Dan, and they said, listen, only one of you can leave. And I, of course, told Scottie, hey, you got big things to do today. Mm-hmm. Second round, PGA, go win that Wanamaker trophy. I'm staying right here in this cell. I'm trying to win a bigger trophy, that Pulitzer Prize thing you're always talking about.
That is how jail works. Who wants to get out? I can get one person out of here.
Right. Yeah, like you do what you got to do for a friend. That's what you do.
Yep. Kevin Durant has zero titles in my record book.
Stugatzbook.com.
How about that, brothers? Yep. Mm-hmm.
Do you guys understand how many different deals Stugatz would parlay? Scottie Scheffler shouting at him like a man from the bottom of a well, help me! Can you help me? Like, can you imagine Stugatz just waddling into a heroic arrest?
You have no idea, buddy.
Scottie, I can help you, but can you help me?
If Stugatz can get his phone working to video and not just turn his flashlight on and run into
It'd
the woods.
It'd be a selfie of him watching Scottie get that's arrested.
That's what you did. That's what Darlington should have done. I mean, what's the matter with
him? He would have made it a cameo. Stugatz would have it would have been, if there could be body cam footage, but a cameo, Stugatz would have recorded it. Yes.
And Blade Runner.
Yep. Dan, I've asked the officers here, how long can I stay? They're not telling me. I've asked. I want to stay as long as I can. Hopefully, you'll come get me out one day, Dan. You probably won't. Scottie will, though, after he wins the PGA or finishes in the top five. But I asked the cops. They said, listen, it could be a while processing all this stuff, everything. I said, listen, I'm in no rush. I'll stay here for as long as I can. How about that?
All right.
I'm offering to stay in prison.
I mean, I think the bid is over. Come back
it's
in
not,
here.
It's not.
Come back in here and spend some
just
time
started.
With
I mean,
us and go ahead.
Serve hard time
and imprison me in the hell I've lived in for the last 20 years. Yeah. Just come right back in here and join us on the show. Pablo, before you came on, we were talking about a couple of things I wanted to get your opinion on.
Ladybugs.
What do people want from their sports coverage? It's a general question, but sports fans, we're in dramatically changing times, and it seems like every broadcast has a whole bunch of complaints about what the broadcast is. The modern age, the new sports fan of tomorrow, what do they want from their sports coverage?
I think they want their sports coverage to make them feel like the thing they're about to watch is the most important event on the world, on the globe, in the world, in the universe. I think that what NBC got right, what am I nostalgic for? I'm nostalgic for those NBC, NBA, Bob Costas essays, Dan. You remember those?
Yeah.
Where it would be him for like 2 minutes setting up the stakes that made you feel like you're about to watch a clash of civilizations. I think that's what people want, is the idea that you're about to watch something important and something special. I think when it comes to studio shows, everybody has been fooled into thinking that Inside the NBA is the model, and Inside the NBA is the best studio show in the history of studio shows, but it's also unreplicable. And so people are trying to do the thing that is impossible to do, which is copy someone else's chemistry with people who don't have it. And so I think the biggest mistake that companies like ESPN make is the idea of, we're going to give you an imitation of something as opposed to selling you the event. And I think the event is the thing that matters. As much as I want to be, you know, a pro gas bag job creator, I think you got to focus on the event.
Didn't ESPN do that, though, on Sunday? I mean, it was, for New York, the biggest event on the globe.
I mean, I don't want to just criticize ESPN's studio coverage, but I would say that if you watched it and you watched Stephen A's tunnel walk, it was great for memes and bad for everybody else. And I think that's another tension in the world of how to broadcast games, is there are things that you can do for the internet audience, for memes, that are inherently funny. And I'm still talking about the Stephen A. tunnel walk. But to insert it into the presentation of, here is the most important game in New York City, you could argue, in 50 years, since 1973, I think that was a miscalculation. Even if it was tongue-in-cheek and funny and something that I laughed at, I think you want to play it straighter.
I got two words that improve every single broadcast around the nation. Bruce Buffer. You're welcome.
I thought of a show ahead of its time, not a movie, but a show. The Jetsons.
Correct.
Yes. Yes.
Still haven't gotten there. Flying cars.
We're getting close, though.
Robot maids.
Yeah,
the show behind its time, The Flintstones.
Yes, that's true. Wow. Different game, yeah, but yes, nice. Great point.
George Jurassic Jetson Park. was riding a copter, mm-hmm. An flying individual car, copter. Yeah. And
a
now,
spaceship, wasn't it? Wasn't it a bit of a vehicle spaceship?
It was an individual, though.
I think they were on Earth just floating. I don't think it was in space.
Right. Was it? They didn't fly rocket ships around. They were driving cars.
Yeah, they were flying cars.
Flying cars.
Still haven't gotten there. Yeah.
Yeah, and now we're close to that. You're gonna be able to Uber, but in the air within a couple of years.
That is just not true.
Put it on the poll.
No, it's true.
Within a couple years,
by the year 2000, we'll have that.
Put it on the poll at Levitard Show. Are we going to be in flying Ubers in a couple of years?
I'm reporting it. I mean, I'm not speculating. It's happening.
The salary of a sprocket, was he a sprocket salesman, a sprocket worker? What did he do for Spacely Sprockets?
It was sprockets, yes.
Spacely Sprockets.
So what did he do?
He was in an ancillary division, unimportant as an employee.
Well, important enough that he was able to afford a robot maid, and he had, his flying car.
He was like the Lewis of sprocket makers. He was somewhere in the back.
Yeah, he was a mid-level executive.
I think he got laid off.
Wow, straight.
Did Lewis?
I don't think he was a mid-level executive. I believe he was more of a factory worker, a labor man quashed by management.
He wasn't dressed like a factory worker.
No, he's a mid-level exec.
White collar, literally.
Not everybody was flying back then, but he was.
Pablo, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
See you tomorrow.
It's that time again. The NBA playoffs are here. And boy, wouldn't it be cool to watch an NBA playoff game in person? Heck yeah, it would. And what better way to do so than by getting tickets on Game Time? Game Time's an authorized ticket marketplace of the NBA, which makes getting playoff tickets even faster and easier. Prices on the Game Time app actually go down the closer it gets to tip-off, which is perfect for people like you who don't plan things out. Or you're just really busy and you don't know you're going to have time to go to a game until the day of the game. And if basketball's not your thing, well, guess what? I'm on the Game Time app right now. And what's this? Oh, Megan Thee Stallion is coming to town. I could also see Bad Bunny or Blink-182, Shakira and more. Because Game Time has tickets to all the high-profile events. Not just sports. You know some of my favorite features on Game Time? I can go on the app and I can see the view from my seats. Because sometimes it looks like they're going to be great, but I have no idea until I get there. But with this feature, I can actually see. Plus, they have the lowest price guaranteed. And as I mentioned, last-minute deals. You can save up to 60% off buying your tickets last minute for sports, concerts, comedy, theater, and more. Plus, Game Time has flash deals, zone deals, all-in pricing. They've got it all, plus the lowest price guarantee. Or Game Time will credit you 110% of the difference. And at Game Time, you always get the Game Time ticket coverage. Your purchase is covered with the most flexible customer service policy in the ticketing industry. Take the guesswork out of buying NBA tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code DAN for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account and redeem code DAN for $20 off. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest prices, guaranteed.
Don Levitard.
Yeah, very
imagine if someone told you you couldn't have a Corvette.
Stugatz.
I'm a grown ass man who's not filthy rich. I can't afford a Lamborghini. Well, I probably can, but that's.
Whoa!
Hey!
This is the Don Levitard Show with the Stugatz.
We have some video to get to with Ron McGill of animals being tickled, a stingray being tickled, a baby gorilla being tickled. Ron, who is the most ticklish of the animals that you can delight in just fooling around with and you will get a playful creature?
You know, I don't usually play around with the wild animals. I mean, there are some dogs that I've had that have been very ticklish, but when you get into the wild animals, of course, all the primates, you know, you see that. And then not necessarily with the stingray there, it's not necessarily ticklish, it's more of a sensitivity. It might be kind of a defensive mechanism, you know, because stingrays get eaten from the bottom. So it might be trying to do
it. Oh, wait
a
minute. So we're showing a stingray torture video is what we're just showing.
It could be. That's not necessarily.
That doesn't look like torture. He looks like he's having a good time.
First of all,
his lips are puckered up. He's just,
Yeah, well, that's you being a little anthropomorphic there. Stingrays, first of all, shouldn't be on their back. That's stressful in itself.
I don't know what that means.
Let's go ahead and it's when you give human characteristics to an animal. Let's.
I would nominate Dan if I could jump in. I would nominate my dad as the ticklish, most ticklish animal.
Wow.
If I could come in there and tickle him if you want. He is very ticklish.
Let's not do that.
Jess, that
looks like you got a haircut. You look very clean cut today,
Thank
though,
you.
There, Greg.
Yes, I appreciate that, Ron. Thank you.
Jess, that hell yeah with food in your mouth.
Stingrays get eaten from. I was going to ask you.
You okay?
Oh, God. You okay?
And you're eating on the air.
Pay myself $5. I was going to ask you, Ron, because you know how humans will be like, don't tickle me. I'm gonna kick you. Don't do it. I'm going to hurt you. Is that what wild animals do, but then they actually will, like, maul you?
Yeah.
If animals maul you, it's because they are being defensive and they think they're being hurt. It's not because they're saying, I don't want to be tickled. They think you're not tickling them. They think you're going to hurt them. So that's probably where they'd be defensive that way. But, you know, there are other animals. You can see baby chimps, baby gorillas, a lot of the apes. They're ticklish like humans. You can see youngsters. They'll actually smile and show their teeth and give that classic ticklish response. But not all these responses, as an example, that stingray are being ticklish. They're actually being defensive.
Stugatz, we're going to play some video here of is it a gorilla? It's a baby gorilla being tickled. I think this is actually tickling as well, but I'm scared at what's walked into the room because since Greg Cody was much younger, his son, who is now an adult, can tickle him in a way that will enrage Greg Cody. Greg Cody is not...
How about we don't do that?
Well, your son's in here now, and now we get to all enjoy before this gorilla video. What Chris believes to be the most ticklish creature in the entire animal kingdom.
Yeah, no, come on.
Maul him, Greg. Maul his ass.
He's old now. I feel bad doing this, but I can get right on the arm. Right.
Get his feet. Right. Get his feet.
Right, enough. Okay.
Woo!
He does not like being tickled. Let's play the baby gorilla, though, probably enjoys being tickled. This is more playful.
That is certainly more playful, yes, because that's an interaction that they would do intraspecies. You know, stingrays don't tickle each other, okay? But this is a bonding behavior between an adult and an infant, and that is a classic, yes, that's tickling.
Is there another animal that, if you were to tickle it, would simply disembowel you? Like, that somebody would feel comfortable enough to tickle and then be surprised that the next thing they know, they've got spikes in their eyes?
A cassowary bird. If you were able to get close enough to tickle it, yeah, once you tickled it, you'd be disemboweled.
Ron, earlier in the show, we were talking about Victor Wembanyama and what he spent his first NBA check on, and he bought a Lego Millennium Falcon. Greg was unfamiliar and thought that it was an actual bird. So is it a bad idea or a good idea to buy an actual falcon? Can we do it, and how much would it cost?
In this country, you cannot do it without a permit, without having a bird of prey falconer's permit. I don't know what the price would be. That would depend on the bird, assuming that you had the permit and you were legally able to do so. But in this country, you cannot own a bird of prey without any type of special permit.
About $100 million for Kirk Cousins.
In South Florida, there are any number of places where you will find exotic animals.
If I wanted a falcon, I could get a falcon, Ron. Yeah. So is it a good idea or a bad idea?
It's a bad idea. You know what? If you wanted crack cocaine, you could get it too. It's a bad idea.
Yeah.
So wait, hold on. Owning a falcon is like doing crack cocaine?
They're both illegal.
How illegal is it to own a falcon? Because South Florida has a whole lot of exotic pets and illegal pets. We can't, I've got to assume, do I have this wrong? If you had to guess, South Florida has more rule breaking in this regard than any other city in the United States.
South Florida and Texas, both of those states are pretty bad when it comes to exotic animals.
What is the strangest thing you have learned of a South Floridian owning as an animal where you would be like, how is that something that they own? They should not own that. That's not allowed.
No, it's the classic. It's the big cats, tigers, lions, leopards, incredibly venomous snakes, you know, baboon vipers, crates, spitting cobras. People own those things in this state.
What's something that looks illegal but is not illegal that I can own so I won't get in trouble but people still think I'm a bad boy?
I can't think of one off the top of my head, Billy. You come up with the greatest questions. I don't know.
Stumped. He is stumped.
One that you can't answer.
So in the interim, let's just play him a video of a falcon on cocaine, please. Oh. Just in general, a falcon on cocaine.
Two crimes.
Oh,
it's just Willie Falcone, the
that's
cigarette.
That's really bad. That's
one
bad.
Of the cocaine cowboys. Lewis, don't ever do that again. The endowment of Ron McGill, I will tell the audience again that the endowment of Ron McGill is something that doesn't have any paperwork, intermediaries. It is just him getting help to the animal kingdom. The listeners of this show have raised millions of dollars for Ron McGill's substantive endowment. He missed last week's show because of the hyena surgery. I didn't know that there was an emergency.
They like being tickled, right, Ron?
Yeah, it was a procedure, actually. We had to do an endoscope on a hyena because people were throwing trash onto the exhibit and the hyena ate it. And, you know, if there's something that people can learn from this is please do not throw things on the animal habitats. Not only is it against the rules, against the law, but, you know, you can hurt an animal. This animal could have potentially died from eating this crap that people throw on there to try to get an animal's attention when it might be resting in the shade or doing something or doing nothing and they want it to do something. Folks, please, please, you don't understand the stress these animals can go through when we have to deal with this type of problem.
Ron, I was at the zoo a couple weeks ago and I almost texted you because I saw, I don't remember the exact animal, but it was like a deer-like animal. And it was in that trench, that like safety trench that exists, I guess, so the animals can't come.
Yeah, in the moat. It was probably a Nyala.
Okay, yeah, I think it was. They can just go down there and get back up and it's fine? It's nothing to be alarmed about?
Yep, no, nothing to be alarmed about. They go down in the moat all the time, sometimes just to get shade, sometimes just to have their own privacy. You know, it's important to us that we can provide the animals a place to go where they don't feel like they're constantly on stage, so to speak. Now, sometimes the patrons get a little, oh, you know, I didn't see the animals time or it was down in the moat. Understand that we have to look out for the animals' welfare as much as we're trying to look out for the people to, you know, to be engaged. So, yeah, animals have a choice to be able to be in sight line and sometimes out of sight line, and depending on the day, especially on those hot days, they're going to look for the shade.
This is something that I've been wondering for a while. Are we going to get any cicadas down here, Ron?
This is a little far south for them. It's a little warm right now. I have seen cicadas, but not these 13-year or 17-year ones that you're seeing up north right now. So we're not going to see that kind of onslaught, but they do occur here. Keep in mind, there are several species of cicadas, and they do occur here, and I have seen them on occasion. It's not something very common, but I've seen them down here in South Florida.
First, we don't get the eclipse. Then we don't get the aurora borealis, and now we're not getting the goddamn cicadas.
We have 108-degree temperatures.
That's
for
all
you,
we
though,
get.
If
yes.
You'd like. We have some of those.
Hey, Ron, in Australia, reportedly, a woman who looked just like my neighbor, Shelley, was swallowed whole by a 13-foot shark. Does that sound plausible? Because let's say she was 5 feet, 5.5 feet. Could a 13-foot shark swallow a woman whole?
And silently. Her friends didn't even notice she was gone, according to the report.
She was swimming with a group of friends, and nobody knew that this shark swallowed this woman whole. Plausible or no?
It's feasible if she's 5 foot tall and fairly thin framed. Yeah, that's not. I mean, she's not gonna. It's not gonna inhale it like you would inhale. I don't know. I'm getting into this detail. The body's gonna be bitten some, but it will gulp it down as it's biting. If you ever watch a shark eat, you'll see how they do that. They just like bite, gulp. And doesn't mean that he's gonna. Oh God, this is awful to talk about. But
poor Shelly.
He's gonna like dismember her or tear her apart in different places. But he's gonna. Why is Stugatz laughing so badly?
Well,
this is really a horrible thing I'm trying to describe here.
You have told us that a human being cannot live for very long inside of either a shark or a whale; that they would die almost immediately.
Yes, absolutely.
Even a whale?
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Yeah, come on.
I've seen Pinocchio too many
times.
Listen,
guys. There are enzymes in your human stomach,
yeah.
That if not protected by a certain lining. Would just burn you up. That's when you get a bad ulcer. You get some bad, you know, digestive problems. Is when you don't have the lining protecting you from those enzymes that basically digest food.
But it seems like there's a lot of space in there, Ron.
Yeah.
That's all right.
A lot
to get
of
comfortable.
Space.
You know what?
What
you watch too many Pinocchio movies, Stugatz.
Yeah, right.
It's not Pinocchio, brother.
I feel like in a whale, I could stand on my hind legs, and not even be able to touch the ceiling.
Sit in a little boat or something. Don't touch the enzymes. I'm all good.
Right.
How many Pinocchio movies are there?
The ceiling.
There's a couple of Pinocchio movies,
the
guys.
The ceiling of a whale. Thank you for your expertise, Greg Cody.
No problem.
Last week, we were having the argument about whether a woodpecker damages its brain, face, head, beak when it pecks.
No, this is what's incredible about woodpeckers. If you were to look at them anatomically, their tongue actually goes all the way around their brain, their head. It's basically like a shock absorber. So they have this incredible shock absorber. Their tongue is so long, every time they peck, that tongue comes out, goes all the way into the hole to get the insects. But in the meantime, it goes around their head and acts like a shock absorber. So it's an incredible anatomy that woodpeckers have that protects any kind of brain damage.
Ron, it is always good seeing you. Thank you for making the time. I will tell the listeners again, if you want a good cause, Ron McGill's really does help the animals. I'm here to vouch for it, and he is an honorable man, and only occasionally does he buy with your charitable funds clothing and Cadillacs. Thank you, Ron. Good seeing you.
Thanks, guys. Have a good one.
Real quick, because Pablo was on with us, and he said he wants his basketball games, his sporting events, to feel like the biggest thing in the world. John Tesh is going to join us later.
Oh, man.
John Tesh has given us the only exclusive rights to music that we have around here. His song, Does This Sound Like Your Sporting Event, is the biggest on the planet.
Wow.
He just gave it over to us. He owns that sound. Amazing. He gave it to us. And John Tesh is going to join us to make us happy with that music later.
Since the dawn of mankind, we've cooked our food over an open flame and debated the best way to grill. One thing not up for debate, grilling and beer always go together. And not just any beer will do. Whether you barbecue Texas style or celebrate Wednesday with burgers and dogs, you need a beer that tastes great and is less filling, so you have more room for food. You need Miller Lite. As you guys may or may not know, I'm a pretty decent cook, especially behind the barbecue. So when I start the fire from my smoker on a hot day, really, the only thing that I have to worry about is what wood I'm going to use. The easiest decision for me is what I'll be drinking. That's a nice ice cold can of Miller Lite. Oh, and by the way, here's a pro tip. It really goes well with brisket. Miller Lite keeps it simple, undebatable quality, and tastes as great as your barbecue. A perfect companion for grill masters across America. With the Miller Lite in hand, grilling doesn't just taste great, it tastes like Miller time. To get Miller Lite delivered right at your door, visit MillerLite.com/Dan. Or you can find it pretty much anywhere that sells beer. Celebrate responsibly. Miller Brewing Company, Milwaukee, Wisconsin. 96 calories per 12 ounces.
This is the story of the one. As a maintenance engineer, he hears things differently. To the untrained ear, everything on his shop floor might sound fine, but he can hear gears grinding or a belt slipping. So he steps in to fix the problem at hand before it gets out of hand. And he knows Granger's got the right product he needs to get the job done, which is music to his ears. Call, click Granger.com, or just stop by. Granger, for the ones who get it done.